Yeah, I think it's great that we're still friends.
Right?
Even after we got divorced.
I know, it's unbelievable.
No, it's great. I wouldn't have it any other way.
Yeah.
I work at Gotham. You still perform at
Hello,
Gotham?
Hello, modern divorce.
Speaking of work, by the way.
Yeah.
You got to get upstairs in 45 seconds.
Oh, really? Yeah. Go fuck yourself. Didn't tell me what to do when we were married. I'm not fucking allowing it now, you son of a bitch. You.
Tonight on Axis TV, straight from New York City, it's Gotham Comedy Live. Get ready to laugh with Charles McBee, Alli Breen, Jason Stuart, Johnny Beehner, and this week's host, Lisa Lampanelli.
Fucking welcome, okay? I know you all probably noticed I look a little different. I lost 107 pounds. Thank you. I'm so beautiful. Even the gays love me. Hi, Haley! Work! And I did get my hair cut, and listen up, lesbians. Now that I shaved it, these fucking dykes think they're gonna get up in my shit. Don't get your hopes up, bitches. Although in 6 years, I might become a lesbian. If I don't find an appropriate mate by the time I'm 60, fuck it, I'm jumping onto the tuna boat. I don't give a shit. Now, Gotham Comedy Live is a show that's live and it's uncensored and we can say whatever we want. So you know what we should do? Most women hate this word, but I don't give a shit. It's my favorite word in the language, and I think you know what that is. The C word. So I think, just to get things up and running, I think on my count of three, we should all just yell the C word. Here we go, Gotham Comedy Live. 1, 2, 3. That is foreplay to me. Seriously, I think that the C word is very sexy. In fact, for a guy to make me finish, all he has to do is call me a cunt and hit me in the clit with a shovel. Look at the Hispanics are like, I got a shovel in the truck, man. Mommy, coño, 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 coño. That's right, I see you, Hector. Don't fucking look away. I see you, you little papi chulo. Adorable. What type of Latino are you, sir? Colombian. Ah, they smuggle drugs in their ass. I see the blacks are here, one right in the front. How are you, sir? Tyrone or Leroy or whatever it is you call yourself. I enjoy that very much. Matter of fact, now that I'm divorced, I was like, wait a minute, maybe I should date the blacks again. Because as you know, I had more black guys behind me than Obama. But since I lost the weight, fuck you, you blacks, they don't look at me no more. I know, it's like they like a big ass, so they have something to hide behind when the cops start shooting. So I thought maybe I'll date an Asian. Oh, there's one. Hello. Oh, my goodness. I know your sister, some dumb hoe. She's very nice. Goody, goody. Have you ever dated an Asian, my gay friend? You have. How was it? Was it good? Okay, depends. I didn't ask what your mother wore. I was talking. The fuck is this fag saying? You're shy. I get it. Well, here's what happened, Ching Ping. I personally have never dated an Asian. So he said, oh, I better rent a porn so I could see what it's like. Because I don't watch no porns. I've only watched one black porn. It's called Cuckoo for Coco Cox. So I went to this Asian porn. There was this yellow bastard giving it to this fucking white bitch. I said, oh, no, thank you. Every time she said she wanted it doggy style, he whipped out a frying pan. Because they eat dog, you fucking idiots. This jerk, I'm gonna have to explain everything to him. Anyway, now that I'm divorced, though, this is what I hate. I hate divorced comics who come up here and crap all over marriage. I think marriage is fantastic. And I'm also thrilled that now in all 50 states, we allow gay marriage. Clap it up. Isn't that terrific? Work, Henny. Matter of fact, I've thought about this for a long time. I think the only people who shouldn't be allowed to get married, ugh, two fucking ugly people. Have you seen the travesty that can result from one of them unholy unions? I'll give you a little example. Say these two lovely cornholers get married. They move in next door. They've got a beautifully manicured yard, and not just because they live next to Hector. They've got a lovely tool shed, very organized with the vibrators in descending order. All the little cock rings are color-coded on penis-shaped pegs. Pretty soon they adopt a little Asian child, because an Asian's easier to get than a real kid. Pretty soon a dry cleaning establishment pops up. Then a nail salon. Then a happy ending rub and tug massage parlor. What's the worst thing that can happen when two ugly people get married? Three words, honey boo boo. That's what the fuck can happen. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I sense you have a sense of humor tonight because none of you pricks had moaned me yet. I hate that shit. But the next joke is one that audiences universally hate and have no stomach for. But I want to ask you if I should take the risk with yous at Gotham Comedy. Are you sure? Don't give me a dirty look, Henny. Okay, I'm gonna do it, but if you don't like it, I would blame the fag. That's all I'm saying. What's your name so I don't have to call you that, Henny? Thank you, Jamay. Oh my God, Jamay. Girl. I mean, he is so gay, he shits Skittles. I'm not even kidding. Love you. Okay, so, all right, here's the joke, so don't freaking moan me. I'll kick yous all in the twat. Here you go. Okay, so I do a honey boo-boo, that's what the fuck can happen. Laugh, 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 laugh. And then I go, you guys, did you know that about a year ago, Honey Boo-Boo's mother was actually dating a pedophile, and Honey Boo-Boo was so unattractive he wouldn't even fuck her. How dare you? It is not Honey Boo-Boo's fault that she did not get to experience the magical light delights of a Mississippi childhood. It's just, if you look it up, you'll see, it's true, Google it, fat kids are never molested. It's true. No, they are never molested because there's never enough candy to get them into the van. And see. Now, you guys, a lot of people know me from the roasts on the Comedy Central. And one of the most famous roasts I ever did was Donald Trump. Oh, my God. Now, first of all, The Celebrity Apprentice, when I got to see Trump, I got to see him up close and personal. 16 weeks in the boardroom every fucking day, and I still have no goddamn idea what's going on up here. If it's alive, if it's dead, if it's orange cotton candy, if it's a ferret with its tail wrapped around. And that's coming from somebody with hair like this, okay? I look like Justin Bieber fucked Marge Simpson. Now, to make sure you're really in the mood for some edgy comedy, I want to tell you the craziest Trump joke that I told at the roast. Hang on to your hats, people. Donald Trump has put up more worthless hotels than an autistic child playing Monopoly. And by the way, the other day, after I got my hair dyed blue, a woman in back of me in Starbucks goes, autism awareness? Autism awareness? Blue? April, autism awareness. I'm like, shut up, you fucking retard. Ladies and gentlemen, are you in a mood for a fantastic show at Comedy Gotham? Yay! We're gonna have the best time.
Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, Charles McBee is taking the stage when we return. And stick around later for more with Lisa Lampanelli when she returns to the stage. Welcome back to Gotham Comedy Live. More great stand-up coming your way starting right now.
We love him here. Big hand for Charles McBee!
Yeah. How we feeling, New York City? Nice. That's what I like to hear. I'm not gonna lie. I'm in a good mood. I just got some good news. One of my favorite aunts is breast cancer free, everybody. Breast cancer. Yeah. She's a survivor. It's dope. She's one of these people who's very uplifting, very, you know, glass half full, positive people. You know anybody like this, right? But she said something to me a while back that I didn't know how to process intellectually, right? Like, she looks at me and she goes, Chuck, I know that no matter what happens, I'm gonna be just fine. Do you know how I know? I was like, how? She goes, because I am an American. I was like, I'm sorry, did your titties fight in Vietnam? Like, what do you... I don't know what that means. She goes, well, in this country, we raise billions of dollars in breast cancer research. Somebody right now is running a marathon for me and my boobs as we speak. America loves titties. That's an exact quote, by the way. America loves titties. It's the new breast cancer awareness. America loves titties right there. I think she's right. We do love breasts in America. We absolutely love, cherish breasts in America. This is how I know that we love breasts in America, because my uncle is a survivor of testicular cancer. See? Nobody gives a shit. You see what just happened? Did you hear the hush that went over the room just now? I mentioned my aunt's breasts. A parade came through here. My uncle's balls got nothing. Balls lives matter. I'm a simple dude from the Midwest, right? Simple dude from the Midwest. I'm not impressed by a lot of big fancy stuff, right? But here's the thing. I was hanging out at the club with my friend Mike, who's a very successful guy in television, right? So we're at the club, and Mike does something I've never seen anybody do before in my entire life. Mike orders a $900 bottle of champagne. Yeah, now I don't know if anybody in here has ever ordered a $900 bottle of champagne in a hip-hop club, or if you've ever watched a rap video before. But when somebody orders a $900 bottle of champagne in a hip-hop club, things get crazy very fast. First of all, four of the most beautiful women you'll ever see in your entire life appear out of nowhere. One of the women has the bottle in her hand. Now, the bottle has 4th of July sparklers, fireworks, shooting out the top of the bottle, right? Am I right? Shooting out the top of the bottle. Then the four women begin to parade the bottle throughout the entire club, right? Now, everybody in the club is focused on this bottle, and they're saying to themselves and each other, oh my God, look who just bought the $900 bottle of champagne. Now, here's the thing about me and Mike. We like to tease each other, we like to make fun of each other all the time. So Mike turns to me in front of everybody, and he goes, yeah, I'm living a life right now. I'm balling. I know you wish you could ball like me. And I was like, whatever. Y'all, I don't know where this move came from. It's not my proudest moment. My feelings was hurt, it's just what came out naturally. Whatever. Maybe I can't ball like you, but I'm from the Midwest, all right? What I can do is go into a TGI Fridays, order the sizzling fajitas, and get the same reaction from everybody in the restaurant. It's the same thing. It's the same thing. Ever been on Friday, somebody orders the fajitas, like, did Jay-Z and Beyonce just show up just now? I'm like, I need to get a sense of the room. All the straight men, clap it up. Straight guys, clap it up. I don't know why some of y'all look confused right now. It's a very straightforward question. All right, same dudes that just clapped it up. By show of hands, how many of you have ever had your lady put a finger in your butt? We don't got that much time. We gotta make it quick. Don't worry, it's just live TV. Nobody. Everybody too shy? I'll admit it. Just me and Kanye, huh? That's it? Word? Just me and Yeezy? I remember like it happened yesterday. Cause it did happen yesterday. And I'm still kind of traumatized right now. Allow me to explain myself so you can judge me accordingly, all right? I'm there, I'm with my lady, right? I'm with a young lady, and she's giving me oral pleasure, all right? Oral pleasure. Now, one of her hands was doing exactly what it was supposed to be doing. But the other hand, the idle hand, started getting curious. Her thumb started to do this circular motion around ground zero. Do y'all understand what I'm saying? My body locked up. I tried to say something, but I couldn't get it out. Before I could say something, bam, security breach. Y'all get what I'm saying? I'm shocked. You gotta understand, I'm a black man that grew up on 90s hip hop. Rough Riders, DMX, Get At Me Dog. Arf, arf. You understand what I'm talking about? There's certain rules that as a black man, I'm not allowed to have happen to me in the bedroom. And the thumb in my ass is on top of that list. There's no way I could look my homies in the face knowing that I'd allowed this atrocity to take place. And I started to scream this at her. But I was too busy coming as hard as I've ever came in my entire... Who knew? I didn't know. I was scared. I needed answers. Am I playing for the wrong team? Do I need to sit my mom down and have a conversation? What is happening right now? So I did what any logical person would do in a situation like this, look for answers. I went on Google. I went on Google and I typed in, what the hell was that, Google? What was that? What just happened? Turns out the male G-spot is located in his prostate. Did y'all hear what I just said? In his prostate. And we got the nerve to be homophobic in this country. What those two men are doing is a sin. No, what those two men are doing is scientifically accurate, according to Google. Have you been on Google today? God hates gays, word. God hates gays, then why would he put the male G-spot in the first place a gay dude would think to look for it? Why would he do that? I'm just asking.
All right, my time is about up now, but I just want to make sure one thing is straight between us before I leave. That story stays between us, right? That doesn't. I just want to make sure.
Yo, my name is Charles McBee. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, Alli Breen is taking the stage when we return. Stay tuned for more laughs on Axis TV. Welcome back to Gotham Comedy Live. More great stand-up coming your way starting right now.
Yes, everybody! Your next comedian, you've seen her on Stand-Up in Stilettos. Put it together for Alli Breen. Thank you guys. Thank you so much. New York, I love it here. I just moved back here. I'm so excited. I love that you don't have to drive. That's one of my favorite things.
The last time I was driving, a cop pulled me over. He asked if I knew why he was pulling me over. I was like, no, I just looked up from my phone and there you were. I don't know what happened. If you're gonna offer a cop a threesome to get out of a ticket, make sure the other passenger in your car is also into it. My mom is still pretty pissed. My dad hates that I live in the city. He gets really nervous about it. Because I grew up in a really small town that was really safe. There was nothing going on. There was no crime. There was no diversity either. I had one black kid in my entire graduating class. And that was it. And no one did anything wrong, especially not him. He was way too identifiable. If he committed a crime and someone had to describe him, it'd be a wrap. They'd be like, he was 5'10", 180 pounds, black. The cops would be like, Brian? Couldn't be anyone else. And my dad, he was the kid of Russian immigrant parents. And they came over here with nothing. He grew up dirt poor. You know, my grandfather had nothing. He had like the shirt on his back, $5 in his pocket, and a bag of heroin up his ass. That was it. They were so much tougher than we are. You know, especially like immigrant grandparents. Someone tried to rob my grandmother on her way home from work one day. She robbed them back. She came home, she had more money and drugs somehow. I don't know how that happened. We have the best bars here in New York. They're the best, yeah! Right? They're amazing. Not always fun though. Like the last time I was hanging out at a bar, this guy came up to me and he goes, I might not be the best looking guy in here, but I'm the only one talking to you. Right? Thank you. I was like, did you just insult both of us? Does that work? I mean, it did, but that's beside the point. The last guy I dated, I met out at a bar, and it started out really well. It didn't end great. But like it started out, he had long hair. I was getting really into it. I thought it was sexy. And then on our third date, he showed up in pigtails. They were braided. He looked like Pippi Longstocking. And it was so early on. We hadn't had sex yet or anything. And then I was so worried because I was like, oh my God, what's going to be the situation down here? Like if that's Corn Road, I'm out. If it looks like you're smuggling Coolio down there, it's just weird. He was a vegetarian, and vegetarians, I don't know if you guys know this about yourselves, but you are pretty fucking annoying. I don't know if you know that. Right? Right there. This guy was the worst, though. He was so preachy, like he wouldn't even eat a McDonald's, which you'd think would make sense because he's a vegetarian, but he wouldn't even eat the French fries. He said they had meat in them. Really, the burgers don't even have meat in them. Have some McNuggets, you'll be fine. I think they're rubber bands. I don't know. But he was also, like, he would try to convert everyone. So he made me watch videos of animals and what happens to them before they become food. They're so sad. I'm watching these videos. I became a vegetarian for, like, 2 hours. And then a meat lover's pizza showed up and it was over. I have no willpower. The only time I wanted to be a vegetarian is when he wanted a blowjob. I just wanted to be like, no, no meat. Thank you. Right? I want to. You did this to yourself, buddy. I can't. But it ended really badly. We were together for about a year, and I found out he was cheating on me after a year with 3 different girls, which is a lot. His excuse was that he said he was a sex addict. Which, does anyone believe that? Like, is no one just an asshole anymore? Does that not exist? And like, no one's just a dick. It's all clinical now. I feel like we are this close to calling it restless penis syndrome. This close. It's coming, you guys. No pun intended. But he tried to get help. He said he went to his sex therapist. She told him he had to stop masturbating. And he asked for how long, and she was like, at least until you leave my office. You have a problem. And my mom's been divorced 3 times, which is a lot. Right? I think if you've been divorced 3 times, your right to vote should be taken away. You're clearly a terrible decision maker. Right? Do your own thing. She does make some bad decisions. Like, she smoked cigarettes for a long time, and she's a teacher. You're not allowed to smoke in schools anymore if you're a teacher, though. You're not allowed to. I think that's really unfair. Right? Like, now, what are teachers supposed to do after having sex with their students? They need options. You guys. No, so I appreciate teachers and parents and anyone who's raising the next generation of kids. Like, my sister has 3 kids, and you know, every parent thinks their kids are the smartest kids in the entire world. My sister's the only parent who's like, yeah, I don't know about these 3. I hope someone can weld or something. She had to sit them down and have that conversation where she's like, you guys know you can be anything you want to be for Halloween. Real life's looking bleak. My oldest niece just got extra credit in her class for learning the alphabet backwards. Now there's a teacher who got a DUI, huh? Not even trying to hide it. But I couldn't raise kids. I couldn't do it. I'm way too lazy. You know, I did the laziest thing you could possibly do the other day. I went and I got an hour-long massage. My favorite. The place where I went, right when you walk in, there was a sign in the lobby that said, no happy endings. Got it right out of the way. Don't even ask. And I realized I am so lazy that if I were a masseuse, I think I'd be an only happy endings masseuse. That sounds so much easier than rubbing people's backs for an hour each. Oh my God, if someone was like, or you can just do this for 5 minutes, I'd pick that every time, you guys. Every time. It's not even a sex thing, it's a time saver. I'd be like, I can do 20 of these in 2 hours. Take the rest of the week off, I got this. But I travel, that's my excuse for being lazy. And you know, I was in Canada most recently, and whenever you travel, people tell you what you have to do in the place you're going. In Canada, it's poutine. Everyone's like, oh, you have to eat the poutine. I didn't know what that was. That sounds filthy, doesn't it? I was like, eat the poutine. Can I just try kissing a girl first? Let's ease my way in. Thank you so much, guys. Have a great night. Thank you.
Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, Jason Stuart is taking the stage when we return. Stay tuned for more laughs on X's TV. Welcome back to Gotham Comedy Live. More great stand-up coming your way starting right now.
Upcoming film, Birth of a Nation. Please clap it up for my friend, Jason Stewart!
Oh, black woman, gay man, same thing, girlfriend. I read in the paper the other day that only 1% of this country is gay, and if that's true, I've slept with everyone. And you know who you are. Oh, God. I swear to God, I'm so excited to be here. I really am. I'm gay and Jewish, so I'm pissed. I'm on a Prozac, a lithium, and a Fin-Fin. I could snap at any moment. I come from a crazy family. How many people here come from crazy families? I love my mom, I'm a mama's boy. And when I was a kid, I used to watch all the TV shows on television, like the Partridge Family and the Brady Bunch. Everyone was sweet, nice, and all the moms and dads were widows or widowers. So when I was a kid, I just wanted one of my parents to die so we could be happy. I love my mom, she's 79 and she still shops at Forever 71. She wears cha-cha heels, plastic earrings, and a snap-on ponytail. That's my mom. when I was a kid, she would get really mad if me and my brother would act up or fight. She'd say, if you kids don't stop this shit, I'm sending you all to military school. I said, fabulous. Get your keys, get your purse, come on. I hear they shave people. I was so gay, I couldn't hide it like him. He's got the wedding ring. Me too. Come on, have you ever had sex with a guy? It's just us. Never once, never at camp. You never rolled over and went, ah, there he is. Oh, man. Oh, I love my mom, I really do. She's just so fun. She lives in Palm Springs now, you know, where all the Jews go to die. And she calls me on the phone. This is a phone from the 70s. It's got a cord. I know, you don't know what I'm talking about. She called me the other day. She said, I just want to ask you a question. I said, well, what? She says, is it true that all gay people invented blowjobs? Oh, Mom, that's so inappropriate. Just answer the question. I said, well, we didn't invent them, but we did perfect them. She says, you're having too much fun. She said, in a relationship with a man, what role do you play? Are you the man or are you the woman? I said, like a role in a movie? I'm Barbara Streisand in The Guilt Trip. She says, Barbara, I love her. Am I anything like her? I said, no, you're worse. I love my mom, I really do. And it, you know, I'm an actor also, and I recently got cast in a movie called The Birth of a Nation. It's about black abolitionist Nate Parker. Oh, no, that's a star, Nate Turner. I'm so, oh, Nate, I love him. Nate Turner, and I play a white, heterosexual, Christian plantation owner in 1831. It could happen. And I had to say the N-word over and over and over again. Now, I've never said the N-word in my entire life. So I'm in my hotel room, I'm practicing the N-word, I'm on location, the maid knocks on the door. What's going on there? I said, nothing, the Republicans won't shut up. She said, I hear voices. I says, it's Donald Trump. Now I'm a Democrat through and through. Democrats here, yes? Through and through. So Hillary, Bernie, Hillary, Bernie, I don't know, I'm a Jew. Bernie, you know. But every time I see him speaking, it's like he's at a bar mitzvah going, who's gonna get the centerpiece? Now Hillary said, if it takes a village to raise a child, you know, we need the village people. I don't know, I'm getting old, I can't believe I'm 26. And shut up, you're bitter and you're angry. I broke up with the love of my life 10 years ago. Aww. He was black, ooh. I'm a Jew, oi. Told my mother, it's not enough that he's not Jewish, he has to be black too and gay. I said, Ma, you've been married 4 times, shut the fuck up. 4 times, 2 she married, 2 she killed. The last one was a multiple personality. We called him 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. I'm dating this Latin guy, he's so cute, his name is Carlos. He's 22, you know, he doesn't call me daddy, he calls me puppy. He had one of those chains that he chained to the boat loop, to the wall, to the couch, because I won't let him leave the house. What do you say to someone that's 22? What's your locker combination? Do me, go to your room. He was shaved everywhere. pierces. I chipped a tooth. He wanted me to pierce my nipple. I said, ugh, I'm tired, I'm old, I'll get a clip on. It's too exhausting. Oh, man. I am getting old. I hate shopping. I used to love to shop. You know, I used to love to go get a cute shirt someplace. But now, where does everybody shop? Costco. Everything's big. You know, Sam's Club. He's a Nazi. How do you know who he is? You know, you guys love Target. Who loves Target? Yes? I walk in. I don't know what the fuck happens. My eyes glaze over. It's like heroin is going through the air conditioning because I want to buy shit. I don't give a fuck what it is. I bought 400 placemats made out of bamboo for no reason. I bought a gazebo. I have a one-room apartment. I bought a Buddha. I am Jewish. Oh, God. 300 rolls of toilet paper. What was I going to do with it? I made a couch. Then I went back and I got 100 more because I wanted a chair to match. So please be careful, everybody. If you go out later tonight, there's that new date rape drug. Have you heard of it? Please be careful, especially the straight girls. Me, I just cut to the chase. I take it before I leave the house. You guys are great. I'm Jason Stuart. Thank you very much.
Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, Johnny Beehner is taking the stage when we return. Stay tuned for more laughs on Axis TV. Welcome back to Gotham Comedy Live. More great stand-up coming your way starting right now.
Letterman Show. Big hand for Johnny Beehner! Johnny!
All right, it is good to be here. I flew in earlier this afternoon and I went straight to the Olive Garden. Yeah, I figure, hey, I'm in New York City. So I'm at the Olive Garden, eating my breadsticks, loving it. I excused myself, went to the restroom. This is the weirdest thing happened. I still don't know. Here's what happened. So I'm sitting, I'm not gonna go into detail here, but I'm in one of the stalls and I hear this weird sliding noise. I don't know what it is. Here's what it was. There was a little kid lying down on the bathroom floor on his back, sliding himself, just pushing himself along the stall, under the stall walls. His head slides under my stall. He flips over, he goes, "Hi, what are you doing?" Now, I don't know how you would handle this if this happened to you. I'm sitting on the toilet, okay? This kid's head pops up under the wall. I'm like, oh, hi. What am I doing? I said, I'm going potty, right? It's a little kid. I'm not gonna explain what masturbation is if he doesn't already know. I mean, that would just be totally inappropriate, right? So it's a little bit about me. I am married. I know a lot of married comedians come on stage. They complain about being married. They make fun of their wives. And I will be doing that in just a minute here. But I want to start off by saying how much I appreciate my marriage. And I think the reason that I don't take it for granted is because I never thought it would happen for me, solely because my last name is Beehner. It's a very unfortunate last name to have, and I've had it my whole life. Okay, picture this, little Johnny Beehner out at recess in third grade, trying to play kickball with the rest of the kids. But I'm having a hard time, because I got this big jerk circling around me, chanting out, "Johnny Beehner has a tiny wiener." No, still funny. Great. I'm in third grade. I didn't know what to say. Only thing I could think to say back to that kid was, "Yeah, I'm 9. Of course, I got a tiny wiener. I'm pretty sure we all have tiny wieners. We're third graders. The hell are you making fun of me? But you want to make fun of someone? We should be making fun of the kid that's hung like a horse. He's the weirdo. The hell's he doing with a grown man's penis in third grade? He's got nothing to look forward to. I didn't mean to point right at you when I said that. I have no idea. So anyways, growing up, I just, in the back of my head, I'm thinking, who the hell's going to want to marry into Beehner, right? Well, about 7 years ago, the stars aligned. I'm out at a bar, and I met Aaron Pagina. And we fell in love. And we got married. Yeah. She ended up hyphenating. It's going good. We are very different. We're very different because she grew up in like a family of hippies. You know, both her parents are total hippies. And I grew up in a normal family. So it's just very different. Like when I was single, I used to use Irish Spring because I liked it. Then I met my wife, Erin. We move in together. She sees my soap in the shower. She's like, oh, no, 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 no. What is it? This is terrible. You cannot use this. That has aluminum in it. I didn't see any. She's like, no, 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 no. You got to use this weird misshapen oatmeal rock I bought from a homeless person at the farmer's market. It's free range. So I'm using her soap. First of all, it hurts because there's like little pebbles in it or something. I don't know. One time I was using it, it cut me. I look at the soap. There's a stick in the soap. I never found a stick in my Irish Spring. That's a big selling point when I buy soap. No sticks. I don't get it. I used to go to Target. I could buy 12 bars of Irish Spring. It cost me like $5. Smells great, comes in a box from a factory, so you know it's soap. Meanwhile, she's buying soap from gypsies. It's made out of sticks and oatmeal. The packaging is just rope. It's just a naked bar wrapped in twine. The label is just a ripped off piece of scratch paper. Someone hand wrote, "Nature's chunk of shit, $14. I don't know how long I can do this. And I'm not saying be with my wife. I'm not saying that. I'll be with her for, you know, a while. I'm saying I don't know how long I can not say anything, okay? Because my wife and I, we never fight. We don't fight. Occasionally, I will question things, but then I just surrender immediately. You know, because what do they say? Happy wife, happy life? Yeah. Oh, I wonder who came up with that. I wish husband rhymed with life. Yeah. That'd be a different world we live in. I don't know. When we were engaged, people would say to me, everyone's advice to me when we were engaged was the same. They'd all say, oh, you're getting married. Oh, pick your battles. Pick your battles. What? Why do we say that to guys? What do we say to women? You're going to win. A lot. I think my problem is I'm way too selective. You know, we've been married 5 years. I have yet to pick a battle. Last week we're at a restaurant and the waitress came around. She's like, you guys doing okay? Anyone need anything? I said, yeah, can I get a refill of my Coke? My wife goes, oh, no, no, he's good. He does not need another one. And then the waitress left. I'm sitting there thinking, what the hell just happened? I want another Coke. I just said I want another Coke. And then this other person said I don't want another Coke. I think I'm getting another Coke. What the hell? Is this my battle? Is this it? And then she doesn't think I'm listening because she just sees me playing through the different scenarios in my head. You know, I'm sitting there going, and she's like, where is your head? What are you doing? What am I doing? I'll tell you what I'm doing. I'm daydreaming. Me flipping the table saying, where the hell's my Coke? I ordered a Coke. I want my damn Coke. All the women in the restaurant are like, oh, my God, you see that monster? He just totally overreacted. All the guys are like, did he? Looks to me like someone just lost a battle. we I'll tell you this. When I was in eighth grade, me and my buddy snuck into his dad's bedroom, and he pulled out his dad's sock drawer, and he had a Playboy magazine in there that he was hiding from his wife. Even at that young age, I remember thinking, oh, man, he's hiding stuff from his wife? Not good. Yeah. If my son ever snuck into my room, pulled out my sock drawer, he wouldn't find a Playboy. He would find a little sandwich baggie with a half-used bar of Irish Spring in it. All right, guys, that's it for me.
Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, Lisa Lampanelli is taking the stage when we return. Stay tuned for more laughs on X's TV.
Guys, I just want to say a couple things. I want to say this weekend, starring here at Gotham, is one of my favorite comedians ever, Brad Williams. He's over there. He's not a midget, he's not a dwarf, he's what they call a little person. I'm being politically correct, right, Brad? He is amazingly funny, and also he offered to do my next bachelorette party. He told me he would go up on me. And he said if I wanted, he'd jump out of a cupcake, so that'll be terrific. Love you, Brad, come see him. Now listen, real quick. I have a time for a quick apprentice story before I go. When I was on The Celebrity Apprentice, I was on that year with that crazy cunt of a Jersey housewife, Teresa. Well, that jailbird, listen to this. One day, the makeup girl comes into my room and she's like, oh my God, Lisa, everyone in wardrobe is saying Teresa's pregnant again because she looks kind of, you know, big. Well, I take a look at her gut region the next time I see her, because nobody loves the idea of a skinny cunt getting fat than me when I was 248 fucking pounds going through menopause. So I glance at Teresa's gut, and it's just a little distended. You know, not African kid with the fly on the face distended. I mean, side note, why don't the G's eat the flies? Just saying. I mean... So, Teresa's gut looks a little big, so I grab my phone and I text to my friend Aubrey, who was on the show, and I'm like, oh my God, check out the fucking gut on Teresa. She's clearly knocked up again with another one of her ugly, awful, untalented kids that will have to pretend is cute and talented when each one of them should have been born with a hanger through its head. Send. Well, you guys, the precise second I press send, I realize I sent that fucking text to Teresa. You've all done it. You know you have. So I was smart, though. I think quick, and Teresa glances at me, and I go, no, 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 look at your phone. And I text again. I said, the text you just received from me is one that I have forwarded to you from one of your teammates. I'm not gonna throw anyone under the bus, but I would advise you to keep your eye on Clay Aiken. She was my favorite girl on the show. And you know me, I love all the gays, the queers, the ass pirates, the Hershey Highway patrolmen, rectal rangers, turd burglars, dick smokers, log jammers, poo pushers, pillow biters, pickle kissers, John Travolta, all of them. Oh, please, thank you for being behind me on that Travolta shit, cause honey, 50 massage therapists are not lying, okay? Grease is the word for what's up his freaking asshole. But
Anyway, just one last thing. I'm just proud to say, even though The Apprentice was stressful, I actually earned for my charity, the Gay Men's Health Crisis, $130,000. I was so proud, you know? And after I took my mere 75% cut, two gays were cured, and they're here tonight. So thank you. Gotta wash my hand. Did you guys have a good time tonight, folks? I had such a good time. What an honor to be here at the best comedy club in Manhattan and maybe the world. Let's bring up your comics for tonight. Charles McBee! Alli Breen! And for me, Lisa Lampanelli, the most beautiful, gorgeous woman in the world, UNCENSORED.